resistance is futile.
Boldly going where no show has gone before. This is the Week in Geek with David D. Squared, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Broadcasting from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, here's D. Squared.
Greetings, people of Earth. This is the Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. All right, let me lay out the show for you tonight. We got our boy Scungy with his pick of the week, and our guest tonight is Dana Schwartz, host of the new podcast on the iHeart radio app, Stealing Superman. But now, Scungy, she not only does this, she did this thing called Haleywood. I don't know if you remember when Bruce Willis tried to buy an entire town in, like, Idaho or somewhere.
I remember something about that.
So she did that. That was her first one. Now, they're Stealing Superman. She digs deep and does a whole, like, 9-part episode series where somebody was at Nicolas Cage's like raging kegger at his house and
walked off.
They walked off with his Action Comics number 1 and Detective Comics number 27, which had the first appearance of Batman. So yeah, there was that. So we talked to her about that, but she also has a podcast with Grim and Mild called Noble Blood. That's Aaron Mankey's thing. That the guy who does the lore podcast we had a couple of weeks ago. Whole lot going on there, and she wrote on She-Hulk. So we'll talk to Dana Schwartz tonight about that.
Awesome.
Yeah, so, you know, but first, let's do this. And now, your top nerd news stories from around the world, brought to you by the Viridian Tea Company. Find them on Etsy. And now, your top nerd news stories. Okay, topping us off, I need to bring that down, and... Let me just play this for you. Bow, bow, chicka, chicka, bow. Sit, Ubu, sit. Good dog.
Great intro.
The new Night Court. The not reboot. It is a continuation of Night Court. Now has its official airing date on NBC. January 17th next year, and they're going to have two back-to-back new episodes with that. Now, Michelle Roach from Big Bang Theory, she is going to be Harry Anderson's daughter. So,
awesome.
Yes. So the continuity is the whole that she is now a judge following in Harry Anderson's footsteps, and bada bing, bada boom, and it's got an all-new cast, mostly except for Jean Larroquette. Jean Larroquette.
Well, he's from here, so he's French.
So John, he's from New Orleans, he's John. John Larroquette, y'all. He is going to be in there. So now, this is weird. In the news article I was reading, it was from NBC. They said, remember the character who played Bull Shannon?
Richard Mull.
I thought he was dead. Apparently he's not. They said he's still working, but I mean, I honestly thought I remember. I know.
Marsha Warfield died. Harry Anderson died. I'm with you, dude. I thought he was dead as well.
Well, apparently, according to the article from NBC, he's still working. So that's news to me. So that's great. I'm happy.
Yeah.
I don't want him dead. So, but he's not slated to be on the show. But if he is dead, I guess they could use like the Carrie Fisher and Mark Hamill and all the other CGI stuff to make them look, you know, like, hey, what was he always saying? Okay. So, Night Court, and that I don't know
such
why.
Such a great show,
I was just excited by that. Now, also in other news, Dave Bautista. So, apparently, Netflix has said that there's going to be a Gears of War movie on Netflix. So, they haven't done their casting yet, and Dave Bautista has officially thrown in his hat. Now, look, he's really kind of impressed me. You know, like there's wrestlers that can act and wrestlers that shouldn't act.
Yeah.
I really didn't think our boy from Peacemaker had any
John
business.
Cena.
I didn't think he had any business being in front of the camera, but Peacemaker, you know, disabused me of that notion. Of course, you know, you got to love The Rock.
It's his niche, though. It's like he can do that.
He cannot expand.
Not everybody can be Dwayne Johnson.
No, right. No, nobody can. So yeah. Dave Bautista, though, like I've enjoyed his work in Guardians of the Galaxy. You know, he's done some other, you know, random things. So now, he took a picture and posted it on Instagram and everything in his Gears of War outfit. And you were telling me that he was in the trailer for the game when Gears of War 5 came out?
Yeah, when Gears of War 5 came out, he is actually a skin that you can download in multiplayer. And you can put him in place of Marcus Fenix. And he did a whole trailer with it. So he's been adamant, like, about playing Marcus Fenix in this.
He looks a lot like him. I mean,
I think he could probably pull it off. I mean, he's that action hero. He's not like, you know, a thespian or anything like that.
He's not loquacious.
Yeah. He's like, oh, look, it's them. Shoot them.
Yeah, there they are. All right, but I mean, you said there was something, like, bad about it, though? I didn't understand what you're getting at. You were like, oh, I don't want to do the show before the show.
Oh, no, I'm just saying, like, I'm behind it. I like the idea of Batista as it. I'm with you 100%. I used to watch him as a wrestler. I'm like, all right, but even his wrestling, like, mic skills, it's funny. Like, when he does Drax, it's so much better than anything that he's done when he was a wrestler on the mic.
Because it's supposed to be, it's such a straightforward character. You know, you everything is literal, you know? And like I do not, like when we played the trailer for the holiday special for the Guardians of the Galaxy, he's like, I did not think he heard you with your small, mousy voice. You know
what I mean? But I mean, not only that, some of the other things that he's done, like the spy movie that he did, there's some other things that he's done that he's just really come into his own as an actor. And I think it's, you know, I'm excited. If they decide to go that direction.
So it's not Henry Cavill?
Speaking of that, I watched Enola Holmes, too.
Oh, so you know what? A good segue, dude, because actually I've been making fun of Henry Cavill for, I don't know, over two, three years now at this point. He doesn't have to stretch very hard to play Sherlock Holmes. It's like, yes, play a guy who has no emotions. He's like, got it. I'm on it. I'm your guy. But I saw this fun little video of him and Eleven, you know.
Millie Bobby Brown. MBB. There you go.
So they had this little funny little like, what do these old time Victorian things mean, you know? And so like his off-camera presence I found to be pretty cool. He seems like a funny, cool guy who's actually more cerebral than I've given him credit for, because he was a history buff. And I know a lot of people have been like, why do you hate on Henry Cavill? He's a nerd at heart and all that stuff. I'm like, I guess probably because like I've never seen him outside of his poor acting range. You know, I've never seen these off-camera things. And this little interaction with Millie Bobby Brown, I found him to be likable.
Dude, he wants to sit down and just paint Warhammer miniatures all day long.
Well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, that,
you know, he just makes a lot of money to do it.
That makes more sense for him to be an introvert and have zero communicative skills, okay? I'm not slighting all our Warhammer friends out there, but they know they got to work on their interpersonal skills. We know this.
But you really just hate on this man.
I do.
But I mean, I liked him in Enola Holmes too. I thought he was even better in this one than they were in the. I think this movie was actually better than the first one.
Okay.
But yeah, I get where you're coming from, but I just can't follow you down that road, man.
Fine, whatever. I don't need company on the road that I'm going down. I'm a loner. I'm a rebel, Dottie. Now, speaking of loners and rebels, Velma from Scooby-Doo is now canonically officially gay. Velma is now gay. They wrote it in that she's got a girlfriend or she's got a crush on an evil scientist girl, and she went goo goo gaga, had the whole awooga awooga eyes in the cartoon.
She likes a bad girl.
Well, you know, so okay. And it's funny to me, though, because like all of a sudden, like people are now upset because HBO Max has a Scooby-Doo thing coming out, and in that, she clearly has a crush on Fred. So now we're getting mixed canonical messages because HBO Max was like, we're making a cartoon for kids. We don't want to kind of, you know, make it overtly what her sexuality is, which, you know, I'm down with that. And, you know, like, why are you putting sex in my Scooby-Doo? I don't need to know that. You know, find the ghost, unmask the villain, eat a bunch of sandwiches, and eat some Scooby snacks.
No. She was going nuts over Sam and the Supernatural crossover, so you can't say that.
Well, that's true. Yeah. Well, here's the thing, though. Like, I remember all the time she would give the side eye to Fred because Fred's like, we got to go do this. And she's like, oh, he's such a meathead. But she'd follow him everywhere, you know? Yeah. And like, so.
He was the boss.
I don't understand, though, too, because why everybody's so fixated on Velma being a lesbian when I need to know if Shaggy is a pot dealer. That's what I need to know.
Like, you have to, like, ask. You have to even, like, yes, think about this?
Well, clearly, because everybody's been thinking about Velma, who she's bedding down with strangers, I want to know what his phone number is, how to get said Scooby snacks. But like Matthew Lillard, who played him in the Scooby-Doo movies, you know, he said he is not a pot dealer, he's not a pothead. Clearly, he's wrong. he's wrong. But in the movie, Scungy, he walks by at the end of, I think it was the second Scooby-Doo movie, he's walking into like the movie, they're walking the red carpet, and he stops and he goes, and then he looks over and you see stereotypical stoner friends that reek of patchouli and weed. Weed. Shaggy when you think he smells a po' boy somewhere.
No, it was pastrami. Pastrami, not weed.
But none of them had a pastrami sandwich. They just had their nasty little flannels. They had the little bacon neck t-shirts and the whole flannel thing going on. One had a beanie and hair. No,
dude,
man.
You are stereotyping people, man.
I am stereotyping. That's kind of like our job here. That's, I mean, come on. So I don't understand. Like, I want to know more about the pothead than I do about, who's bedding down strangers. So I don't know.
What about Fred?
Oh, Fred, he's totally into autoerotic asphyxiation. All those ascots he wears, he's just driving. He's not trying to solve crimes, man. He's driving around town trying to find somebody who will choke him with his ascot. That's exactly what's going on there, man. There's no question about that. All right.
We've gone off the rails, ladies and gentlemen.
You're welcome, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to The Week in Geek with D-Squared. When we come back, it's almost Christmas time, even though, we all overlooked the poor Thanksgiving, massacre, that the poor turkeys, who are mostly dead from avian flu right now.
Yeah.
Poor turkeys can't catch a break, man. Either I'm getting the axe or I'm getting the flu. Forget about it. Hey, I'm a toyky. What do you want? So when we come back, though, we're going to celebrate Christmas the only way we know how, with horror movies and action movies. That's how we roll, all right? This is The Week in Geek with D Squared on iHeart Radio. I don't have Scooby-Doo, so I play Speed Racer.
Follow the bouncing ball and the flying ball.
Throw it up to Fort Jackson. Showtime!
Oh, yes, sir.
And the dunked ball.
Get out of the way! Two-hand flush, Brandon!
And the blocked ball.
Steal Herb Jones.
And the behind-the-back, no-look passed ball.
Cannot be serious what we're watching right now.
Hear the game on the radio home of Pelicans basketball.
Get on your feet, New Orleans. My goodness.
News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Box tea again? Why don't you try the tea blends from the Viridian Tea Company? They sell blends that are guaranteed to make you think outside the box. With blends like Quantum Mechanics, Caligula's Herbal Nerve Tonic, and Manta Ray Dreaming, your tea experience will be out of this world. Look for the blends at Tubby & Coos Mid-City Bookshop at 432 North Anthony Street or online at Etsy at the Viridian Tea Company. So put down the box and order some tea from the Viridian Tea Company today. Sincerely, your taste buds.
Now, from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, this is News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
Hello, this is Chris Walken. And if you've got a hankering for more cowbell, you can get it on The Week in Geek. Come on. We'll be right back.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I am your host, D Squared. Now, as always, we want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Follow us on Twitter at Twig Radio, on TikTok at The Week in Geek, and the Instagrams, The Week in Geek. Hey, Scungy, how can people listen to this show?
Well, if you missed any part of tonight's show, or you want to hear Dave talk about autoerotic asphyxiation again, you can always find us on Spreaker.com or download Spreaker for your smartphone or tablet. We're also on iTunes, YouTube, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, and the beautiful iHeart Radio app with the candy-like button.
Yes, you too can click that little red button and be a part of the show. Leave a 30-second message. Maybe, you know, you have your thoughts on, maybe you got Shaggy's phone number so we can, you know, like, you know, get some Scooby snacks after Snoogies.
You're just like a dog with a bone on this, aren't you?
Well, yeah, because they're also breaking my heart with the whole Velma thing, too. That's, you know, I mean,
you thought you had a shot?
Well,
or was just Lindo Carolini?
We didn't even get into that. But yeah, look, I mean, come on, she can play for both teams. I mean, clearly, you could. It's the 2000s now.
It's the 2020s.
It's the 2000s, right. Okay, so now it is time to celebrate Christmas. I want to start off with this one. This one is called Christmas, Bloody Christmas, and it's coming out December 9th. And look, when I saw this thing come across my newsfeed, I'm like, what the hell is this? Because you've got all these, you know, like, look, we grew up in the 80s. You get all the, you know, what was it?
Silent Night, Deadly Night.
Yeah,
stuff
right.
Like that.
You know, all those Christmas slasher films, they were awful, but we love them because, yeah, you know, that's what we loved. This one seems to be sort of in the same vein, but maybe like Chopping Mall meets, you know, Christmas, Deadly Christmas. Here, take a listen to Christmas, Bloody Christmas.
The U.S. Defense Department has spent over $1 trillion on the most cutting-edge robot technology. Introducing RoboSanta Plus for the upcoming holiday season.
RoboSanta Plus.
What are you going to do this fine Christmas Eve?
I was potentially going to go meet up with a dude.
No, it's not Velma.
Merry Christmas!
A humbug.
Ho, ho, ho! Merry Christmas!
New animatronic state-of-the-art Santa Claus featured at our own TW Bonkers is now the subject of an international recall.
A recall? What could be wrong with him? What could possibly
be wrong? A
piece
of electronic equipment?
The metal silent deck the halls?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Santa?
Oh! What?
This guy killed the kid next door!
Killed the kid!
In the kid right at the gate! I know!
Oh,
there's the deadhead! Oh! They get right into it, man.
Yeah.
And then the cops are like, I don't believe you. You're crazy. They hear people getting slaughtered.
Give me a gun.
What is that?
It's him.
Oh, Santa Claus?
Yeah, it's Santa Claus.
Yes, bleeping Santa Claus.
He's got like lasers coming out his eyes.
Freaking laser beams, man. Awesome.
Have you heard from the boys down at the scene yet?
They're still down there counting bodies.
Merry Christmas!
Good Lord, it looks like it's going to be so bad.
It looks despicably awesome. I mean, like, and so it's on Shudder, and I think it's actually going to have some sort of theatrical release, too.
Dude, Shudder's going like crazy with all the stuff they're releasing.
Here's the thing, though. I got, like, Full Moon Movies, all the things that had, like, you know, like the Puppet Master and all these things.
Subspecies, all those.
Yeah, like, I mean, these movies are a huge niche, and I use that word fondly because we're a niche, but horror movies, and I've asked several directors that we've had on the show, horror movies are fast and easy to make. You know, it doesn't have to be an in-depth plot. You don't have to worry about a whole lot of character arc, character development. It's like, okay, Here's some teenagers smoking pot and you know, not watching the kids at camp. And here comes the angry, you know, whatever, fish people. Yeah. You know, they show up and they just start slaughtering everybody. But those movies are cheap and easy to make. And plus, look, you got Lethal Weapon, you know, which is people are trying to lobby as a Christmas movie. You've got, Oh my God!
Die Hard.
Die Hard. Like, all I can think of
advent
calendar of him falling off Tokihama.
Oh my!
I know the building. I know, right? It's somebody screaming it at their radio
somebody is
right
really
now.
Look,
I have an excuse. I'm riddled with ADD. Yeah. My brain works too fast for my mouth. So. I don't even know where the hell I was. But so that all these Christmas movies, you know, and you want action, but like, I don't want Hallmark movies. This is like Hallmark movies for dudes.
It really is, yeah.
This is what it is now. But wait, there's more.
Oh.
David Harbour. Remember, you know,
Hopper
from Stranger Things. Also the ill-begotten Hellboy. Yeah, right. That one, we don't talk about that. But He is perfect niche character for this, what we're about to do. But also John Leguizamo. John Leguizamo is innocent. He plays the bad guy. John Leguizamo has come so far from like the Super Mario Brothers days when he was in that first one.
Why do you have to mention that?
Because I'm making a case for how Leguizamo really sucked a long time ago. And I'll never forget till the day I die the apparently, I forgot. I'm going to die soon now. I just forgot. No, the
John Wick?
No, Romero. George Romero made the Land of the Dead where, you know, like you had the Fiddler's Green and all that stuff. He was so worried. Like, I watched the after credits thing, and John Leguizamo was just like, I'm in a Romero film. I just don't want to bleep it up. You know, and I'm just like, and you're looking at like a zombie, it's like, yeah, you might mess this up, bro. You know, it was the 80s, 90s, man. You could screw it up. But now he's clearly not that guy. Yeah. But spoiler alert, this one is called Violent Night. It's about, you know, a dude dressed up as Santa, but there's a twist. Take a listen.
You ain't driving, are you?
I steer a little, but the reindeer do most of the work.
This is my fourth year as a Santa. How about you?
I started the whole damn thing.
Does that mean...
Wait for it.
Welcome to your worst Christmas ever.
Leguizamo.
Let's go!
You have $300 million in your personal vault. That's what I want
for
Christmas.
It's like
Die Hard. I don't want any trouble, okay?
Someone's gonna scooch up that chimney.
He got in a fight!
What is he?
Because
it's not your typical mall Santa.
Yeah.
Santa, are you there? Daddy said you were very busy tonight. My name's Trudy Lightstone.
Trudy Barstow.
Santa?
Yeah, Trudy.
Santa?
No, my nice list.
So I got to stop it right here because at that point, you find out that he's not some Secret Service agent as a mall Santa. He's not some sort of ex-special forces. It's the real freaking Santa Claus. He pulls out a magical list, checks it twice, and there's Judy Barstow. And then that's when the hijinks ensue. The music Santa is awesome.
Christmas!
Some seasons beating.
The puns are great. You ain't this more. Naughty.
Who the hell are you?
Boss, what if he really is the
There's
real?
No such thing as Santa.
Well,
he's bad, man.
Bad man.
Not all on my naughty list.
They're all
naughty.
Naughty.
That's naughty!
And what do you do to the naughty ones?
I give them a lump of coal.
As he puts a grenade in his pants.
Yes.
I gotta watch.
And he puts a grenade in there, and he's like, he's walking away, and he's like, I gotta watch. And he turns around and watches the guy blow up. And during the whole, like, montage, you see him just, you know, like, stab somebody with a candy cane.
Yeah.
But the best was, he defends a knife attack with his sack, and it's a bag of holding. The guy stabs into the bag, Santa's bag, and cuts out the present on the end of the knife. It's just like, just awesome. But wait, here we go.
I believe in you, Santa. Christmas! Christmas!
Come on.
He just stepped in.
One of you did that?
Reindeer.
Prancer? So unprofessional.
So there it is. Violent Night coming out December 2nd. Now, it is actually going to be on, it's a release in theaters, a theatrical release. And I left my damn notes on my desk, Scungy. But the it's by 87, Studio 87, I think is what it is. They have done the Dead Snow series. And what's cool about that is like, you apparently had never seen the Dead Snow series.
I know of them. I just haven't seen them.
Basically, you know, it's a slasher horror thing, but like with Nazi zombies. These poor hikers find some of Hitler's gold, and when they steal it, the Nazi zombies come to life, and it's a blood gore fest. It's awesome. But you know, we got Leguizamo and David Harbour, and then the guys who wrote like a... oh my God, I'm blanking on some of the movies though. It's just amazing. This movie is going to be awesome.
And I can't. I printed up the stories for you,
and you bring in one freaking paper.
I didn't grab them.
You grabbed them
out of the thing.
Oh my God, you're worthless to me.
I'm always worthless, but I think it might be streaming on Netflix. There's a chance.
What?
That it might. Yeah, it says it might be streaming.
I think you're full of it.
Well, I hope I might be.
Well, all right. So I guess we'll leave folks with this before we go to our final break. No, two things. I got phlegm. So phlegm. Quantum Leaps, you know, the new NBC series. You know, we were talking about Night Court. So Quantum Leap, like I watched the first one. I haven't watched the rest because I just, you know, I mean, look, I love the original Quantum Leap. And so, but, you know, I gave it a shot. It seems okay. I just don't have the time. I don't even freaking know when it airs.
It's another show we have to add.
I know, right. I'm not even caught up on Andor. I mean, I'm so behind on everything. But, so the Quantum Leap thing, they've sort of built on the whole Sam Beckett Quantum Leap thing. Because remember, it was sort of nebulous, like the whole time travel. Like, yeah, you could leap within your own life, but he could also leap further back if it was like a descendant. We still don't know who the all-powerful being was that was like, hey, you know, this is, you know, you've got to fix this problem. And they strongly hinted that it was God. You know, that it was God. Yeah. Now, this one, because what they're building on the time travel thing. Apparently, what they've discovered is that if you keep leaping forward in time, you can build up enough momentum to leap into the future. If you keep going backwards, if he keeps leaping backwards in people's timelines, if he builds up enough leaps backwards, he can go, boom, further back into time beyond his own lifespan. So it expands your time range. And what they've already done in the series, and now, I mean, I guess spoiler alerts, but I haven't watched it, though, and I want to now because these little tidbits are awesome. He's able to punch himself into the future, and they actually create a town that was never there. And there's also this nebulous sort of form that speaks to him that you think might be God, but now it might actually be somebody in the future, and that all these things that Sam Beckett and now the new guy are fixing is to create a future for whatever this guy is in the future. It's like this is what Kang the Conqueror should be.
Yeah, exactly.
But we're going to get some freaking desk clerk in Marvel Phase 5. I'm more interested in this nebulous, who is it? You know, like, this is actually a mystery and makes me want to watch the show because now it expands the range of Quantum Leap and it adds a layer of not just wacky hijinks each time, like, oh, now he's this person, now he's that person, hob here, you know, like, I wish they would bring that back. The guy said, oh, shh. You know, come on, man. The whole charm of it was that he said, oh, boy, and not oh, bleep. You know, it's like, come on, man. Do better.
You're stick in the mud. You're old.
No, I'm
old fuddy-duddy. Don't curse on my shows.
Well, no, but oh, boy was just. Yeah. Shut up, Scungy. I hate your face, man. All right. We need to go to break so we can talk about your stupid pick of the week. What is your stupid pick of the week anyway?
Sonic Frontiers. I'm talking about Sonic.
Really?
Yeah.
What?
There's a new Sonic game.
Why?
I'll wait. You know, that's what we call a lead-in.
No, it's tease, you idiot.
Tease, lead-in, whatever. I'm dumb.
Yeah, all right. So, when we come back, Scungy will be dumb just for you. Now, who won't be dumb is our guest, Dana Schwartz, host of Stealing Superman, Noble Blood, New York Times best-selling author. Dana Schwartz will join us after Scungy rambles about another Sonic game that we probably didn't need. This is The Week in Geek with Z-Squared on iHeartRadio. Ho, 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 ho.
D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe at 8228 Oak Street wants to remind you that they are open for business. Tables are available for your next game night. Also, the Adventurers League is still running on Fridays at 7 p.m. and Magic the Gathering drafts are still on Saturdays at 1. So come over and check out their expanded inventory of miniatures and miniature paints, board games, RPGs, and TCGs. Find them on Facebook at D4 Tabletop Gaming Cafe or stop by the shop at 8228 Oak Street, just two blocks off of Carrollton. Or go to their website at d4cafe.biz.
Jezebel Johnston, Devil's Handmaid by Nancy Hansen, is now an audiobook read for you by Brian Hell. It's a tale of a young girl from Tortuga who disguises herself as a boy and bluffs her way onto a pirate ship, chasing after her one true love, only to find adventure on the high seas. Jezebel Johnston, Devil's Handmaid is available on Amazon, Audible, and iTunes. Get your copy of Jezebel Johnston today.
Now, from the Gregory Ricks and Associates Wealth Management Studios, this is News Talk 99.5 WRNO.
This is Kate Mulgrew for the Week in Geek.
Just kidding. It's Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, the Major from Ghost in the Shell. Listen, or the Tachikomas are going to get you.
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. Now, if the Tachikoma don't get you, the robotic Santa might, or the real Santa might. It's going to be a dangerous Christmas, man. We're going to have robo-killing Santas. We're going to have, you know, not ex-cons. What was the one fat man with Mel Gibson?
That's Mel Gibson, yeah. Where, like, he, like, a rich kid, like, hired an assassin to kill him.
And he was actually Santa in that one, though, too. Yeah, he's got so many crazy things. Yeah. I don't know. I'm actually down with that. I don't know why, because look, you got Christmas Story 2 coming up, you know? I mean, so
it gets away from the normal tradition.
I know
tradition.
You're super excited about Christmas Story 2. So if you want, you can go back to listen to last week's podcast on the iHeart Radio app or at Spreaker.com and hear how excited Scungy is to hear about the new.
We'll see.
Yeah, let's do this.
Scungy's pick of the week.
I am not what you would call a handsome man.
I love lamp.
Scungy's pick of the week.
You might be an idiot savant.
Woohoo! Scungy, what's shaking, bacon?
So yeah, so today we're talking about Sonic Frontiers.
Ooh, tell me more.
It's a new Sonic game, and I'm going to be completely 100% honest with you. There has not been a good Sonic game in about 10 years.
What?
All right. Now, the only good Sonic game they've had in the last 10 years is one called Sonic Mania, and the reason why it was good is because it was actually made by fans, and Sega caught wind of it, and they were like, oh, we actually, like, okay, here's some money. Go ahead and finish making
nice.
This.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So at least they knew
it. So it wasn't like Lars Ulrich with Metallica, like, hey,
cease
little girl,
desist.
You did a great cover. You owe me money.
Exactly.
That didn't really happen.
Sonic's actually gotten a resurgence in the last couple of years because those two movies that came out were actually good.
I didn't think the first one was good. I mean, but it was okay. The second one actually was much better.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, because Dean dragged me to the movies for that one. The first one, I was kind of like, yeah,
it was
whatever.
Okay, but I mean,
the second one actually was pretty good.
So
I give him that.
So, like any old franchise, trying to give new life.
CPR.
They've made it. They've made it open world.
Oh,
all right.
What?
So you have 5 different islands that you can explore.
And so do you fast travel like?
It's got this rail system that you jump in between and go between the islands and whatnot.
Why would Sonics need?
Well, because
rail
it's fast. It's like the old. It's like grinding on a rail.
Oh,
so he's like grinding.
Okay.
So the game is. So you've got a different structure to it. You have an open world where you can go around and you get all these collectibles and get these keys and these gears to unlock the cyber levels. Now, the cyber levels are kind of your traditional Sonic level where you're running really, really fast and go across the level, get as many rings as you can, and get to the end. So as you do that, you get these keys that you use to unlock the Chaos Emeralds, and you're trying to collect all the Chaos Emeralds.
Okay.
So now those are really cool because they're short and they're contained. They're only like, you know, maybe like 2-minute levels or whatnot.
All right.
But there's a bunch of them. But the main meat and potatoes of it is you in this open world, exploring, finding all these different items and whatnot. And you can, it's actually got almost like an RPG element to it.
Okay.
Where you get these hearts and these teardrops that you can increase your attack, increase your health. Also, you collect these little, basically you rescue these little people, these little creatures.
Like, all right, let me just stop here for a second, because all I remember about Sonic's world is that 1982 or
92,
where it was just like they played musical instruments, and you remember that god awful cartoon, like the Dr. Eggman had taken over the world, and it was just bad. It was bad. So, like, I don't know. Diddly poop about the Sonic verse.
They're really so it does have a rich story, but I never really followed the story either. Now, according to one of my guys who works for me, he's like, this is nothing but it drops like little hints and homages to throughout the entire Sonic universe, and like Easter eggs that people like who are Sonic fans are going to absolutely love.
All right.
But the story is actually pretty cool. It's about this ancient civilization and what happened to them, and you're trying to figure that out. And you have some really good interactions with the characters, like Sonic and like with Amy and Tails and Knuckles, and you get to like meet them and talk, and you actually get a lot more interaction with them than you would in past games.
All right.
So that's really cool.
It
is. And you can also like increase your speed.
Yeah,
you can increase your ring capacity, which I got to say, don't worry about that.
Ring capacity?
Well, the more you can carry more rings, which like in all Sonic games, when you get hit, you drop your rings and that's your health basically. But you can increase it, but you really don't need to because they have this unbelievable moon called the Psy Loop.
Okay.
Where you basically run in the circle and complete the circle. It like gives a trail behind them. And when you do that, it instantly creates coins. So you can constantly just spam coins the entire time that you want to.
Sweet.
But you can also use it as an attack where you can surround your enemies and it does one big attack to all your enemies that you've surrounded. Which leads me to actually the weakest part of the game, which is the combat.
Well,
it's Sonic's never been really about. He's done like the homing attack where he's a ball and runs into him. But this actually has like combos, and you can do this move and this thing and this and this and fight different enemies in different ways. And then they have these mini bosses, and they're kind of like it's kind of
super ricochet bounce. Ba-ding!
It's spamming the X button basically.
Button mashing.
That's it. Now they have the boss battles. No, those are cool.
Okay.
And we don't want to. I'm not going to spoil those because they're really really cool.
All right.
But all the other battles are kind of like Now that being said, it does have a hodgepodge kind of thing because there are all these little different mini games that you could do. Like one day you're in Sonic Spinball, and another time you're doing a 2D platformer. So it brings all kinds of things together. And I gotta say, this is probably the best Sonic game in a long time. It's a good foundation, and I think if they improve on this, the next Sonic series, this is going to be, it's a good place to start.
Right, right. Okay, so, all right, well, price and platform, good sir.
All right, so this is going to come out on, it's out on basically everything. It's out on the Switch, it's out on the Xbox, it's out on the PlayStation, I believe it's on the Dirty Dirty PC as well.
Okay.
It's $59 for everything, and it is not on Game Pass. I know I don't really say that a lot, but it is not on Game Pass. But
how rude!
It's a fun little game that I'm doing.
I don't need a next gen console though, right?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely.
All right. Well, that's what I was worried about. Okay. Yeah. All right. So before we go to break, we gotta do some sad news.
Yeah.
Ever since Brian died, I stopped posting like celebrity deaths. You know, there was a time where we're just like, you gotta run to the presses. If it bleeds, it leads, you know? So Kevin Conroy, the definitive voice of the Batman, has died at age 66. And you know, so I broke the rule and posted that because this one, like, no matter what people thought, when you heard his voice, whether you knew his name or not, when you heard that voice, Batman. The man conjured Batman to everyone's mind just by opening his mouth. And you've got this great homage from Mark Hamill. I mean, so many of our listeners are posting pictures when they got with him at some of the conventions. And I think, you know, Look, he's going to be missed, and it's the definitive voice.
It was the first solo interview I ever did for this show was with Kevin Conroy.
And we lost that interview.
I'm going to try to find it somewhere, well, so I think I got it on a file somewhere.
Hey, maybe we'll play that next week.
We can play that next
week. There you go. All right, coming up next, Dana Schwartz. This is The Week in Geek with D Squared on iHeart Radio.
Listen to WRNO on the iHeartRadio app. Sponsored by Dudley DeVosier Injury Lawyers. Call 504-444-4444. That's 504-444-4444. Non-attorney spokesperson, Chad Dudley, New Orleans.
There is nothing like quality when working with a business. That's why Banks Media Connections make sure that your work is done with class, professionalism, and style. Social media and marketing, IT work, videos, decals, documents, business cards, resumes, flyers, and presentations, Banks Media Connections has all of your media and clerical needs in mind. Contact me, Malcolm Banks, at 251-287-4854, or reach out to us on Facebook and Google. Banks Media Connections. If you have a need, we can help with speed.
Hey, y'all, D Squared here, and I'm joined by a special guest, the Go Forblin, to bring you a special announcement. That's right. Go 4 Games, your friendly neighborhood game shop since 2010, is moving to 4953 West Napoleon Avenue in the Napoleon Plaza. Keep up to date with the move and Go Forblin's adventure on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Go4GamesNola and GoForGamesNola.com. What's that? Oh, he says he can't wait for you to see his new pick of location at 4953 West Napoleon Avenue.
It is I, Starfire of Tamaran, here to tell you, you are listening to The Week in Geek on the radio. This is the radio, yes?
Welcome back in to The Week in Geek, your source for geek and pop culture news that's trending now. I'm your host, D Squared. Let's go to the guest line. Podcaster, journalist, New York Times bestselling author, Dana Schwartz joins us to talk about her new podcast, Stealing Superman. Dana, how are you doing today?
I'm fantastic. Thank you so much. How are you?
I'm doing great. Look, let's talk about your podcast, man. And this isn't your first foray into this, just to kind of set the stage. You had Haleywood last year, but also Noble Blood with Grim and Mild Studios. I guess, first off, let's talk about Stealing Superman, though. What, tell me about it.
Stealing Superman is an 8-part miniseries that tracks, famous eccentric actor Nicolas Cage loves comic books. And sometime in the late 90s, he bought what is arguably the most valuable comic book in the world, Action Comics number 1, the first appearance of Superman. He, is a comics obsessive and an avid collector. But then at some point, probably around a Y2K party that he threw, the comic goes missing. And so this miniseries podcast tracks what happened to Nicolas Cage's podcast, how it was stolen, who stole it, and then, not to spoil anything, but if he ever gets it back. But through that story, we also get to tell a sort of wider story about the mythology of superheroes in American culture and about art theft.
Well, I just listened to the first podcast on the way in, and it's so funny because a few things jumped out at me. How much his staff really loved him and that they called him, a very earnest person. He didn't pay his parking tickets. He had people to do that. And the mere idea of somebody stealing from him was just almost, he couldn't fathom that.
Exactly, especially because the opportunity would have been at one of his parties when it would have been someone that he knew or at least trusted enough to come into his home. That's what makes it all the more sort of scandalous. And also that someone would steal the symbol of truth, justice, the American way. I mean, imagine how Superman himself would judge you.
Well, and then they also apparently stole Detective Comics 27, right? So they got to be worried about Batman, the vengeance of the night coming after him now too, man.
Exactly. They steal actually 4 of Nicolas Cage's comic books, and we track what happened to them. And what's also sort of fascinating is the way that comics over the last decade even have shifted from sort of fringe collector objects to massively important and valuable pieces of art, you know, that are sold at these international art auctions for millions of dollars.
You know, it seems like they always kind of find new ways to, like, you know, store their money, I guess. You know, like it used to be tulips back in the day. You buy that or you know, you would buy art because it was easier than carrying around a whole sack full of dollar bills. So, you know, it makes sense.
Dana's- That's absolutely fascinating. Yeah, Nicolas Cage is someone who just, I think, genuinely loves comic books. We also get into in this podcast how he's tried throughout his career to play Superman. There were several failed attempts. And his stage name, Cage, actually comes from the Marvel character Luke Cage.
I did not know that. Shut up. Really?
Yeah. Yeah, he's was originally Nicholas Coppola, but he changed his name to Cage.
Wow. All right, well, say, like, you learn something new every day. Dana Schwartz is our guest, host of Stealing Superman on the iHeart app. Download it. What are you waiting for? Now, look, let's talk a little bit about your other work, though, too, because Noble Blood, you know, with Gurman Mild, Aaron Mankey, and that, like, this, I'm a huge history nerd. Both my parents were math professors, but I waved bye-bye to math a long time ago, so I got into history. Now, this is something where you dig into the royals, but kind of like the darker, dirtier side of, like, Catherine the Great bathing in blood suck kind of stuff, right?
That's exactly it. I love history, but I totally understand when people say, oh, I just don't like history, because I think a lot of the ways it's taught in school is just memorizing.
In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Yeah, that's the boring
side. Exactly. It's boring. So I love to tell, each episode is its own story. I love to tell stories from history. These were wealthy, powerful people, but they were also just people. And I think getting to dive into their stories and tell them in ways that are interesting is sort of a dream job.
Now, Dana, going back to Stealing Superman, though, and I guess Haleywood as well, what was it about these stories in particular, why you decided to drill in on these particular stories and make, you know, a huge, you know, miniseries out of them?
You know, I think the line between nobles and celebrities is not quite as far as people think. You know, even though the nobles that I'm talking about on my podcast are several hundred years in the past, they were still incredibly wealthy, famous, powerful people. And I think that line between celebrity is something that fascinates me, because at the end of the day, famous people are, you know, famous and rich, but they're still just people. And so being able to track Nicolas Cage's rise, the way he spends his money, and then this sort of saga, really, of how his comic book got stolen, I mean, it just fascinated me. Any good story really gets me going, and that's why I love doing what I do.
You talked about, you know, like the royals and then modern day celebrities. I'm thinking, you know, was there maybe somebody in like Alexander the Great's army that had like a coin that had his face on it? It's like, dude, that's Alexander the Great. He's my boss. He's a great guy. He would never, you know, hurt an elephant. And then meanwhile, they're going over the Alps with elephants. You know, just I don't know why that jumped in my head.
For sure. I think that these are stories that repeat over the centuries, and it's so exciting and fun to get to trace them. I mean, this is a universal story.
Dana Schwartz is our guest, host of Stealing Superman. Haleywood is already out and complete, but each week a new Stealing Superman drops. Now, look, one of the things I want to talk to you about is She-Hulk Attorney at Law. You were in the writer's room out there. And look, I really enjoyed the series. I think one of the funniest things I ever heard was when she goes to work for the law firm and the guy's like, here's the best place to go poop. And anybody who's worked at a corporate office knows exactly, you know, sometimes you got to go and you want, you know, you need peace and quiet. I think it was the human side and of the She-Hulk. Talk to me a little bit about She-Hulk Attorney at Law.
It was such a pleasure to write. I felt so lucky to get to play in that Marvel sandbox and write with such an amazing team. I mean, it goes back to loving stories. I mean, all the better if it's also a story about a woman who can transform into a 6'7" super-powered Hulk. But it was so much fun to get into the nitty-gritty reality of what her life would actually be like.
Now, let me ask you something, and this is a little more serious question, though, because you got so many of the Marvel fanboys that are just absolute pieces of crap, and I don't know how we get away from that, but, like, the backlash that She-Hulk got, where some people didn't even watch the damn show, and they're like, oh, yeah, it sucks, CGI's crap, how hard is it kind of combating that or tuning that out when you're working on these shows?
Oh, I mean, the good news is I don't really care. I think there's a lot of people who are going to yell and be upset on the internet at anything, really. But then it's just not for them. I think the people who understand what we were trying to do with She-Hulk and would have fun with it and enjoy it, that's great. I am far too busy in my life to try to win over mean people who operate in bad faith. It just doesn't interest me.
Absolutely. That is Dana Schwartz, Stealing Superman, out now. And, you've got your book out. The second book is coming out. Yeah, Immortal. And is the second one out or is it coming out?
The second one, the sequel to Anatomy, a Love Story, is called Immortality, a Love Story. And it comes out this February. It's available for pre-order.
There you go. Dana, look, thank you so much for your time today. And I can't wait to find out who done it, who took Poor Cage's Action Comics number one. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much.
All right, Scungy. So maybe they hid the Action Comics number one in the pyramid over there in the St. Louis Cemetery. We should go there after the show.
It's not that far of a drive.
We could be like pyramid spelunkers or something.
Yeah, that's a good idea. I mean, you know, you've got a shovel.
No, but maybe we can get some of the homeless people under the overpass to do it. Because now that I'm thinking about this out loud, you know, we're announcing our intentions to go desecrate a grave. But is it desecrating a grave if nobody's buried in it yet?
Probably not. Look, I'm sure we pay him $5.
Would it be breaking and entering?
What? Well, into the cemetery, yes. Into the grave, not.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, there we go. All right. So yes, Dana Schwartz, Stealing Superman. The new episodes come out each week. All right. As always, we want to strongly urge you to check out the Facebook page, facebook.com/TheWeekInGeek. Check out us on Twitter. Look at that.
English.
Check us out on Twitter at Twig Radio and the Instagram's The Week in Geek. Hey, Scudgy, how can people listen to this show?
Well, if you missed any part of tonight's show, you want to hear your favorite part again, you can always find us on Spreaker.com or download Spreaker for your smartphone or tablet. We're also on YouTube, Stitcher, Spotify, Google Play, and the beautiful iHeartRadio app.
Yes, with that candy-like
button.
Well, hello there.
Yes, you too can be a part of the show. Just click that little red button, leave us a 30-second message, and bada-bing, bada-boom, hey, forget about it. All right, let's get the heck out of here, dude.
Really?
Yeah.
It's time already?
If it's
going
to play, I don't know why it's not playing.
There
we go. Live radio, nothing like it. All right, so look, we're like 2 weeks away from freaking Thanksgiving, man.
Oh, God, don't say that's a four-letter word in this platoon.
And Black Friday started like a week ago for you, right?
Oh, God.
I don't know when Black Friday is, but it sure as hell ain't the Friday after Thanksgiving. All right, I need to get out to the Renaissance Fair, too,
man.
Oh,
it's such a... Look, Mike and Christy are out there. They're doing their corsets and whatnot. Go and check them out.
There you go. All right, so, that's about it. Let's get the hell out of here.
Let's go home.
Till next time, keep your nerd flag raised high.
WRNO-FM, New Orleans, an iHeartRadio station. Available everywhere on our free iHeartRadio app. Number one for music, radio, and podcasts all in one.